Okay, so I'm going to take you through the last few slides. I know we've bombarded you with a lot of information, so only three more slides for you to really pay attention. And what we're going to do now, what I'm going to share now is I'm going to ask you to zoom out a bit. We've talked a lot about the programs, the details of the programs. But we're going to think now for a moment about how all of this essential knowledge that they've been talking about, that our kids really, our children deserve to learn, how does it fit together in the limited time we have in the day? Okay, and I'm going to share our thought process in a nutshell. There's like a million things we think about, but I'm going to try and communicate our thought process in a nutshell for how we make these decisions. Okay. So I think the first and most important thing for us to realize is that when we take decisions about the timetable and what needs to go into the day, the thing that's at the top of our mind always, always, always is what is best for our children's learning. What will result in maximum learning for our children? Okay, that is always the question we come back to. Should we change this? Should we put this in here? What should be given more time? That decision is based on what is best for our children's learning. And then, so that's like the tip of the iceberg, the learning. And then we decide, okay, to get to that, what is the essential knowledge, skills, attitudes that we need to provide them with? Okay, so this is the basic question we answered during this decision making. Okay, there's a lot of effort and time going into that. So let me show you about what goes into the timetable. Okay, so broadly, we think there are four categories of knowledge, skills and attitudes that our children need, okay? There's of course literacy, numeracy, language, math, right? A core skill. We have all our academic subjects. We have sciences, social studies, computers, second language, and they get more and more differentiated. We have our co-curriculars, right? Creative arts, physical education, very essential to our children's development. And we have, as you heard earlier, the socio-emotional learning, or what we're calling personal leadership and development, a very essential part of learning. Now, what I've tried to show you here, I did my best to put all of the complicated things in one slightly less complicated diagram over here. But what I tried to show you is from grade 1 to grade 9, how do we think about what needs to be prioritized for different ages? Okay? Now, what we realized is in the early years, in the primary years, we really need to provide the children with a very strong foundation. Okay, because let's look at the different areas. Can you see language and math? In the early years, if my children don't develop strong language skills, literacy, they're not fluent readers, they don't have a good vocabulary, they can look at a text and read it and understand it quickly. If they don't have that foundational skill, what's going to happen to all the other subjects later? It's going to have an impact on every other academic subject. So in the early years, we have to focus on developing language and numeracy. Same for numeracy, right? If I don't have strong number estimation skills, what's going to happen not only to maths, but to all the other subjects that involve numbers, sciences, economics, anything, right? So there's a large amount of time dedicated to that. Of course, there's academic subjects, right? So we have foundations of science, social studies, computers, second language foundations are put in place. And if you see here, a lot of time is given for exposure to the creative arts and the sports. So we have 16 periods in the school week itself where children can explore different creative arts, physical education, find out what they like, what they're good at, develop foundational skills in all these areas in the school day itself. That is a priority at this age. And of course, I won't go much into this, but as Pooja said, foundations for socio-emotional learning. Today's world is going to require us to not only manage our emotions, but take a lot of complex decisions, work with large teams. Those are things that they will have to do. And for some reason, we often assume it just, they learn it incidentally. They don't, it has to be taught. Okay. So the focus on these in the early years is strong foundation, exposure to all the different aspects of learning. And then as they move up to middle and higher school, we shift a little. So then the focus shifts a little to specialization, deep learning, and mastery. So what happens to language and math? Now language and mathematics becomes a subject. It becomes a discipline where you learn, you know, your pure mathematics, you learn literature, those kind of things. And your academic subjects start to become more specialized. So social studies becomes history, civics, geography, sciences start splitting up, everything starts becoming more specialized. You learn more technical knowledge, it becomes deeper, and you're becoming more of an expert in those disciplinary areas, and you need to create time in the day to do that. And of course, we continue arts and physical education, but now we bring in the element of choice. So you've had exposure for 4 or 5 years, and now you know what you might want to pursue for mastery at a higher level. So they have clubs, they have excellence program, and you might need to do some after school stuff to pursue everything that you want, because the academics needs to be covered. That is our role as educators in a school. And of course, socio-emotional learning and personal development will continue, but in a more appropriate way as they shared in their programs. Yeah, makes sense. There's a lot of thought that has gone into this, a lot of effort and time thinking about how do we optimize, how do we make sure every minute of the day for our children is used effectively. Okay, so what are the implications of this? We realize that to provide this program that our children really, really deserve, we need a little more time. We need 25 minutes more in the day to make this happen. Okay, I see a lot of smiles, but I hope you understand that a lot of thought and very, very purposeful planning has gone into this process. I'll call Siamak now too. There's one more thing. This doesn't imply any increase in fees. Okay, it's just an increase in time. This will be borne by the school. There's no increase in fees. Yes.
Okay, we're closing. That's it. There's not much more. Recap. So the stuff we discussed today, we're going to be introducing the personal development and leadership program, which is social-emotional skills related, but also learning how to learn, helping our kids become independent learners. We're going to be doing Zern math, most probably, with more grade levels. Citizenship program will be introduced to more grade levels as well. I'm feeling like a film star. Everyone's taking, you're taking pictures of me or this slide?
Oh, I thought you were taking pictures of me.
Swimming will be replaced with yoga. We're going to reduce and make assessments more purposeful. We're going to reduce the breadth, but increase the depth of the syllabus. We're continuing with Exceed, and the new school timings are 8:15 to 3:15. Now we have about 25 minutes or 20 minutes for questions. Oh, sorry, one more thing before that. We were very encouraged to read that 86% of the parents agreed when they were asked, I'm proud to be a part of the TGA family. And that doesn't mean 14% disagreed. Actually, only like 1% or agreed, the remaining one neutral, but 86% agreed. It's very encouraging. We saw that also in the triple the number of survey respondents, right? So we're really feeling this partnership. We're really starting to enjoy this partnership now, and we look forward to it growing over the future years as well. Questions?